We do have us a new lead in black. What's going on? We are back. We are live. New episode of Uncut This Talk. This is episode 65, Wishful Thinking. Shout out to everybody that's coming through and joining us tonight. Let's see what's going on. Yo, yo, got my co-host and Nadia joining us. What's going on?
Hello.
Got somebody new joining us, Ratting with Ricardo. How you doing?
I am good.
I appreciate you coming through joining us.
No problem. It's an easy going Friday. Just been chilling.
That's what's up. I came across Ratting with Ricardo, P-Valley. She was doing a review, and I was like, oh, I like this. I like her review. Let me reach out and see if she would like to come on and join me in the deal. I sent the link. I don't know if you had got to check it out or not, but of course, me and the deal do P-Valley reviews.
Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off. I went.
Oh, you good?
It was Power, Raising Kanan. You were talking about the relationship between Jukebox and Kanan, and how calling back to the original Power, how he was like, I don't want to do this. And then we get to see what their relationship is like, and you still realize Jukebox still harder than Kanan was ever.
Yes. Even in the original.
Right. She was harder than Kanan in the original and in, like, you know, this prequel to whatever Kanan's story would become when we meet him as an adult. And then
she calls him out a lot about that, too.
Yeah, and then it's also, like, Jukebox would probably be alive if, you know, Kanan never, like, actually got in good with Tariq because he saw Tariq as himself. And I was like,
I never looked at it like that. I was looking at it as his son. Like, he was like the son that he never had. Well, you're right, though, now that we're watching this prequel.
Yeah.
So now I'm thinking about it. Yeah, you're right.
Because a lot of people were like, oh, no, he just saw him as a son. And the theories were, oh, no, that, like, Tariq is, you know, Kanan's son. And so is Raina, like, the daughter. But it's just like, no, that's not what it is. When you look at the prequel of what his story was before we meet him as an adult, who, you know, originally was in prison,
mm-hmm.
eventually gets out of prison, offs his own son, and then is pulling, if you've ever seen the movie Takers?
Stop!
Yes, I've seen Takers.
Okay, so you know when T.I. gets out of jail, he's just so upset.
Yeah.
Oh my God, he's so upset, honey. You know, he is so upset, so he got to set everybody up to get got, is basically what Kanan did. Because it's just like, I'm upset. Y'all took my stuff.
That's a good comparison, by the way, but it's like, it's Takers, and it's like,
listen, I only watch because I love Paul Walker and Idris, okay?
I give you that. Because watching T.I. dressed up as a security guard and taking him serious, it's like, even if I'm in this movie and I'm a pedestrian, it's like, no, this is not a security guard. He's not a security
guard. John, I was like, the people, like, the extras on the street just walking by and he dressed as a security guard. I'm like, that's T.I.
Because he's still talking like T.I. Damn.
Like, okay. But it was just like, in that sense, that's what it came to me, because it was like, he gets out of jail, he's so upset, and then it's just like, I've watched Takers so many times that you're giving me T.I. from Takers because you're upset that they took over your business, so now you got
even with the backstory. Yeah, it's kind of similar to Kanan, T.I.'s villainous version in Texas. Yeah.
And then with Kanan, as we see him as a kid, and then we saw Tariq as a kid, it's like, it's the same thing. Y'all had all the opportunities in the world, except for the fact that both y'all parents was out here selling them, you know, that stuff. Because I don't know if I could say it on your platform, but your parents...
Yeah, let's not cut this talk. Oh, yeah, okay. We good. We wrong.
Your parents was out here selling them drugs and getting the people in the community hooked, and then you got the people scratching all over the place. And it's just like, y'all had all the opportunities in the world. I was like,
both of them, Ghost and Rock, was trying to push them to do better things, even though they was out here doing what they was doing. You're right.
Both Ghost and Rock was pushing them to do better things, but it's like, how are you going to push them to do better things while they living in your household and you out here running the streets and running the block and, you know, knocking people down and knocking over corner stores and selling drugs and then, you know, getting the apartments and standing up there like...
When you do your Raising Kanan reviews?
I don't.
You don't? Okay, yes. You might need to join me for mine's then on Sunday. Very knowledgeable.
I gotta watch this show. I gotta watch season two.
You ain't on season two yet?
No, I haven't started season two because I was watching P-Valley and then I was doing Real Housewives.
That's understandable.
I was like, ooh, a Sunday? Mm-mm, I don't know if I can handle all this. And then I was doing, because I do Am I the A-Hole Reddit stories, and I was like going so hard. I was doing them multiple days, like 7 days a week. And then I started to get burnt out. So I was like, I got to reel it back on that because I was like, I can't do burnout when this is what I'm trying to do. But it's like with Kanan and Tariq, Kanan as the adult saw himself in Tariq. And that is why it was like, well, you know, Jukebox family and all, but this is a younger version of me. And
but he's still going down that path, so it didn't kind of matter of him shooting Jukebox. So.
It's like family versus the younger version of me. Who is it going to be? Okay, I got to choose the younger version of me. Jukebox, you know, I set you up nice. You have a nice fume, okay? But you the police, so they're going to give you a nice fume, but I'll make it even nicer. You're going to have a nice headstone. I'm a wrestling fan. I'm a wrestling fan, but I also love me Selena Quintanilla. So it's like, hey!
I don't know Jukebox.
So you don't know Selena?
I don't watch wrestling no more. I ain't watch wrestling.
No,
oh, Selena. Oh, my bad.
I was like, I'm a wrestling fan. So I have somebody's headstone in mind because I just watched like a documentary over this person. But then I was thinking Selena. I was like, Jukebox headstone either got to look like Selena's headstone or the Fabulous Moolah's headstone where she got a whole bench and everything set up for hers. And I was like, you know, she family, so you at least had to, you know, do it right. Even though the police was going to take care of it, you at least had to set her up with a nice headstone. Send her out and stop.
She was police, though, so.
This is true. I was like, they going to, you know.
Shout out to Real Little Bit Review for coming through, bro. Appreciate you taking your time to come through. I know you out here busy in these YouTube streets.
I'm going to stay busy. You already know the vibe.
Oh, yeah.
It's good, man.
Appreciate you coming through. Shout out to the TV commission. You already know the vibes. They just did that sports tonight. Then y'all just do the live on the sports TV commission.
Yeah, that was at 7.
Okay.
It was pretty fun.
What sports? I'm nervous.
We talked about everything. Basketball, football. You know, it was just sports day.
And we got NFL coming up.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. The Chiefs have been playing.
Well, you're a Chief fan.
Listen, I'm from
Tennessee. You said it like your team was so much better.
I mean, I ain't put on no colors, and I see my man Brillo in here with the Detroit on. I mean, I ain't put on no Carolina colors. It's all good. I was going thinking about it, but I said not yet.
Look, I'm from Kansas City, so you always have to root for the home team. We ain't got no basketball.
Carolina in the building, Detroit.
We ain't got no basketball team now. But, you know, our basketball team, you know, decided they was going to move to California and become the Sacramento Kings. But I digress. We got football team, and being from Kansas City, you always have to root for the home team. Now, when it comes to them Patriots, we don't speak their name in this house. That's a surefire way to get put out, and I'm not trying to get put out. I like where I
understandable.
Live.
That's very understandable.
And that they player, you know, he left the team and went to another team and then won the other team a Super Bowl, we can't speak his name in this house either. It's poison. That's surefire way to get you put out, too. I'm not trying to do that. Yeah. I don't even know who that is.
Panthers. That's a good side right there. Chiefs and Panthers. Lions and Panthers. But anyway. Yeah.
The Panthers.
Appreciate everybody coming through tonight. We're going to go ahead and try to get started with the show. Like I said, this is a new episode of Uncut Ish Talk. You know you coming through. We got the verses. Of course, we try to jump into some topics. One of the main topics I want to jump into, and I don't know if y'all watching it. I know it's a lot of TV shows we are here watching or whatever, but the Murder, Inc. documentary.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, it's actually interesting, especially when they're talking about the music. But I feel like they kind of getting distracted from the music because every time Irv Gotti started talking about Ashanti, it's like, we can't stick with what he's talking about when it comes to the music because it's really some good points and some good moments he's bringing up when it comes to the music. Those tracks with Jennifer Lopez, The whole thing with the DMX, Ja, even the way Ja Rule was making his tracks, and give credit to Ja Rule, man. I'm a G-Unit fan all day long, but I got to give some credit to Ja Rule, not only for his writing credits, for even Irv Gotti and his producing credits. J-Lo might not be somewhere to who she is if she would have got them two tracks from Irv Gotti. I'm just saying.
Also, don't forget, you know, that lady you just mentioned, because I feel like she only got two good movies. Two good movies.
Enough.
Oh, two Jennifer good. Lopez.
Two good movies. Don't forget, she probably wouldn't be where she is if Mariah wasn't divorcing her record label husband, and he felt like, you know, he had to get at her. And
you're talking about Sony too, right? Because they mentioned him in the documentary.
Yeah, they were divorcing during the time, and not even divorcing, but I think they had already divorced, and it was basically like he was trying everything to make sure she don't put out another album.
And that's kind of what he did with this situation, because Mariah was, I think, originally was going to be on Unreal Remix. But he talked to Irv Gotti and kind of said, well, you need to put Jennifer Lopez on it. Get out Mariah out of here. Put Jennifer Lopez on it.
Man, they shoved Jennifer Lopez down the black community throat so hard. I ain't sugarcoating that, and they did. Anyway, that's all I got to say.
It's true, and I've been telling people recently her song Jenny from the Block, because a lot of people have said that she doesn't sing on most of her songs. I'm just saying this. After this, go to YouTube, look up the demo for Jenny from the Block, and you will hear that not one thing changed from the actual song they put out versus the demo that was recorded.
Well, that was
song played.
And it's not her singing.
She sang over Christina Milian's hook. She lip synced to Christina Milian's play, I think.
I never heard that song. But then again,
Have y'all had a chance to check out
the Doc Loop? Anybody got a chance to check out the Murder Doc?
A little bit.
Like I said, it's interesting.
Good Murder, Inc. I'm straight.
We gonna get Jahi
Flowers. Like I said, I'm a G-Unit fan. I'm 50.
We gonna get Jahi Flowers.
These moments kind of stick with you. Especially when they're talking about DMX. You know, Irv Gotti, say what you want to say about him. He did bring in DMX and Jay-Z. And Jay-Z is on this documentary. And they is getting into these good moments. Like I said, the music moments are good. It's just when he's talking about Ashanti. And he still, besides the Drink Champs interview...
I can't get past that.
Okay.
What'd you say, Rope? I don't know, man. Irv Gotti's so sucky to me, man. I just can't stomach it.
I'm not a fan of the man. I'm not. But like I said, it's just with the doc, it's what they talking about and what they getting into. It is interesting. Like I said, music. If you was around at that time, you remember Ja Rule, and it was all over the radio. Ashanti. The tracks that Irv Gotti was producing. Fat Joe Ashanti, all of them tracks. It was a Murder, Inc. onslaught as far as the radio back in those times.
People were so sick of Ashanti singing Baby in every song, and they wanted her to get a new song. She was the butt of a lot of comedians' jokes, because it was like, can you make a song that don't have the word baby in it, okay? You got 15,000 songs with baby in it.
That was like one of her top tracks, though.
Yeah. So, I mean. Here's the thing. I love a good docuseries. I do. It would be more interesting to me if it was focusing on the music and then, like...
That's what I'm saying.
Maybe, the politics of everything. Like, you know, let's talk about the fact that Mariah was supposed to be on this song, but, you know, got taken off. Maybe delve more deeper into that situation. Instead, every 5 seconds is Ashanti. Let's be clear, sir. She ain't said nothing about you. She be performing on stage in her nice little Jasmine outfit, because that's the last thing I saw her wear. She was on the Versus. She minded her business. She looked good for, like, she 40.
And she still hydrated. Minded her business. She ain't saying nothing. They make sure they let everybody know that once they do the documentary, they try to reach out to Ashanti. She went down. Of course. Like, the way he's talking and everything.
But the way he talks about her,
fucking way.
In my opinion, the way he's talking about her, which overshadows anything else, and then when you hear Charlie Baltimore and Vita talk about the whole entire situation, because I got thoughts on that, the way he talks about her, it seems like he's obsessed with her. Like, he just can't get over her. And here's my thing I want to say about that situation. Sir, I went to the Wikipedia, you know, down there to the Google, and the Google told me that Ashanti, via her Wikipedia, like, depending on, like, whenever she was signed to Murder, Inc., and then y'all start working together, you would have had to met her between ages 16 to 18.
She was 19
is when she start, like, I don't know, putting out music or doing whatever, but to meet the record label head and do all that stuff.
What up? Hello. What's going on, homie? Appreciate you coming through, like, bro.
16 to 18, but even then,
I bring you a little trap content.
Hi.
Thank you, live tonight. Ain't you on that rap is?
Even at 19, she's still, even though she's legally an adult, she still can't drink. She still can't rent a car. There's a lot of things she can't do, so she's still child in my eyes. So
they didn't really touch on those moments when people on the outside are talking about that.
Yeah, I was like, she was 32 and separated. And then from what you said,
it ain't easy to find, bro. I had to go to a Philo TV to watch.
Oh,
and it's seven parts.
Hold on.
Listen,
I got it.
Ain't it
seven parts?
How many parts?
I don't know how long it is.
They ain't finished
it. It's long. Last time I looked at it, it was like five parts. Listen, I got a free site, if y'all not against us, where, you know, you can go watch it if you want to watch it. But other than that, I'm not watching this. For the simple fact is, you were
32. It's the Murder, Inc. documentary.
You were 32. She was 19. If we just want to say those were the ages, you were also separated from your wife. And most of the music, like when the ex-wife talked about the song Foolish, he was like, oh, that was about me and my ex-wife. Why would you do that to that lady? Putting y'all business out there in the streets like that. And then, but then I called him, he built like a big toe to me. I'm going to just say, he built like a big toe. A beige big toe.
Oh, it's only
toe.
Five, okay.
I think it might be more than that for your little trap content. What episode they on right now? They on three, I think. And they about to be on four. Yeah, you might be right. You might be right.
You and these
days.
I love it.
Listen, I call him Idiot Guy Lil Beige Big Toe. I don't like he makes me not like him. And then there's the Vita and Charlie Baltimore talking about the situation where he wasn't really focused on their career and helping them. And then, like, their music didn't go where they needed it to go. And it's kind of like, you know, y'all speaking y'all truth. And it's good to hear because it also goes to how is he as a boss and how is he running his record label? If you're so, it's giving obsessed with this. She was a girl. She wasn't a woman.
And that's important, too. Vita and Charlie Baltimore, they showed Charlie Baltimore. She was raw. Like, she was rapping. And the fact that you put them in the back burner, especially Vita, too, who was becoming kind of popular at that time, too.
But I wanted a Vita album. That was some shit I wanted. Like, when I first heard her, I was like, I want an album. Like, why ain't she? Like, I was waiting on that shit.
And here's the thing. It's just like, Vita had a built-in fan base already because she was the girl in Belly.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
She already had a built-in
soundtrack, too.
She was an adult when she played that part, though, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. I got hella problems with Hollywood because I just found out about a lot of shit, and them and this was white girls. They were like 15 kissing 25-year-olds, but this is acting. They're just acting. What the fuck? You ain't kissing my 15-year-old? No.
They started a lot now.
A fan of Herb, but as far as like with the music business and people getting pushed to the back burner, I mean, that's part of the game. Like, you gotta can't depend on a label or nobody else to get yourself out here. I haven't heard it, but for me, it's sounding like they making excuses, blaming Herb for, you know, their situation. There's been so many artists that's been pushed to the back burner. Like, you gotta. And it might not be right, but if you push you to the back burner, you still got to release and prep. Or you just going to give up because you going to let him do that to you?
They mentioned it, too, because of the fact that Ashanti came in and her popularity card going up because them songs was good. So it's like, wait a minute, we got to hold off. She's coming in. The audience is talking about her. They're not talking about y'all right now, so y'all got to wait. They talking about her. It's the money, the music industry, the business.
I think if...
Dirty game.
If you wanted to get your artists like truly out there, because while and it's up to the artist. Like, I have to bring up a rapper named Snow the Product. I don't know if y'all know her, but she's a dope rapper. Okay, so she's talked about it in some of the interviews that she's done over the years, how, you know, she wasn't getting, like, the push from when she was signed to the label. She wasn't getting the push that she needed, and she wasn't getting the type of time that other artists were. And she took it upon herself to really get out here and get it. And, you know, maybe back then that wasn't, like, the mindset. Like, I'm signed. I've probably worked with other people before, and they've taken care of me. And maybe when I'm signed to this record label, I'm expecting you to at least do just a little bit of what they did for me in the past before I was, like, truly signed to somebody. But personally, I think, you know, if Ashanti got this wave, she's riding with the R&B, because R&B and rap, while they're not, like, there's not a far distance in between them, two different genres. Y'all could have had Vida and Charlie Baltimore, not just in the videos, because they was in her videos. Y'all could have had them featured on some of her songs. Like, y'all could have found some songs to have them featured on, and then they could have rode that wave into their own lane, and then everybody could have been making money together, and they wouldn't have felt like they were put on the back burner instead of playing, you know, background actresses.
Shout out to Pretty Girl Love Trap Content. You right. Back then, there was a lot of gatekeepers and protocol, but I still feel like that's what's going on too, kind of now. Especially when they want to have certain people at the top of the billboards or whatever.
Well, but once you sign a record, you are bound. You can't just release music. When you sign when you're signed with a label, you can't just be like, oh, I wrote this song, I'm releasing it. That's not how that shit works. Period. That's why a lot of people are independent. That's why Ciara went independent. They wasn't letting her release nothing because they worried about numbers. And you know how you keep talking about her songs replayable, but she don't give a fuck. She wants to put out dance music. And she don't want no label stopping her from doing that. She don't care about numbers. That's not what her career is based on. But
yes, at the same time, numbers. It does matter when it comes to numbers, because the label got to make their money.
That's why she's not under a label now because she's trying to fulfill her passion.
A label. When somebody just wants to make music and that's their passion and that's what they, like, truly, that's what, you know, your ancestors in the Lord or, you know, whatever your religious beliefs, if that's what the people told you in your head and your heart, that music is your passion and that's what you want to do, after you've been signed to a label and it's just like, well, now you're back in a situation of, you know, it's really like the label is your parent and you're back as a child. And as a child, you were told what you can do, what you can't do, where you can go, where you can't go, how to dress, what not to wear, what to eat. If they really like control you like that, they're telling you how to do all these things. So when people decide to go independent or they stay independent, then people are releasing whatever music they want to make. If it's good music, they're releasing good music. If it's trash music, they're going to release trash. If it's a little dance bop, they're going to release a dance bop, and they're going to have people in the clubs dancing to it. Personally, I feel like rap should go back to when the girls down in the strip clubs was going to make or break your music, because some of this stuff I'm not into.
I feel what you're saying.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I like what I like. I don't ever talk. I mean, it's just like you said, you're not into it. I mean, I'm around young people a lot, so I kind of like got a different type of ear for the music. It is what it is. I don't think it'll ever go back to like the golden era or just, you know, bars and beats and stuff.
Well,
I mean,
certain like, artists got Kendrick's in them out here.
I mean, you have, like...
what you mean? Oh,
I like the variety. Oh, I like Bella,
what
the variety.
You mean,
man, bro? I'm not a fan. It's like, for me, music, it's about, like, a vibe. I recognize that Kendrick is a rapper. And he's spitting. But, I mean, musically, like, I don't know. I just... With me, it's different. Like, I can recognize
an artist. Not your type of art.
Not my type of artist. Even though he... He's cold. He fire. Like, he's spitting, but I just, the music to me, like, I'm not about to ride to that. I don't want to study, so I'm not putting that on. Like, I just, I don't wish, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you don't got no charisma. Like, you know what I mean? I don't know. It's different. It could be a rapper that's not really saying nothing that I'll play over one of those artists just because of the music. It's different, though.
I don't mean like, because I'm not trying to take over anything, but who y'all listening to now? Like, rappers. Because I've been listening to the girls a lot. Because there's a lot of them. I love May. I put, like, her album, the new one that just came out, I've played that all the way through, and I was like, I don't listen to many albums, like, straight through without skipping anything, unless I've already heard the song. If I've already heard the song, you know, I'll play it to give you the play, but it's just like, I already know this song, and I've been singing it, and you know, everything for a while. Flo Milli.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like Flo Milli new album.
Yeah, Rico Nasty, which I love the song that her and Meg did, Scary. I was like, they gonna play that out for Halloween. Big Boss Vet, she like really like she used. I think she used TikTok to her advantage because a lot of her stuff like starts to go. They'll take a sample of her song on TikTok, and then they'll make like a new dance or whatever to it. And then it'll get played over and over again to hit your For You page, and then it's stuck in your head. Now you gotta go listen to it. Cardi, but you know, the last thing I think she put out was the Hot Ish thing.
I wasn't feeling it,
so I was like, I just wait for the next thing she puts out. There are so many, because there are so many girls out here putting out music.
You listen to Dolce?
Yeah. All right.
I'm not really much of a BET Awards.
You don't like her?
No, I mean, I'm not hip to it. Like, I mean, I reckon, like, Meg can rap. She can flow, but.
What about Lotto?
Yeah. And she's, Chella's coming on Sunday. The VMAs, I know she's Lotto is nominated for a VMA for Best Visuals for her the song she put out after the overturning of Roe versus Wade.
Okay.
Which was very quick.
Thanks for having me. I had I would have stayed longer, but I had something to do real quick. So if you have me next week, I'll be up here, back up here. Appreciate the love, y'all. Show.
Yeah, shout out to the TV crew. I'm gonna
stay much longer. All right, appreciate y'all.
Shout out, Bill, little big review.
Money Long. She's not rapping. She's singing, but
yeah, she's not a rapper. But like, I get what you're saying, and yeah. Like, she got an interesting come up in the career. As far as like her, she's been shelved multiple times. Now that's somebody that persevered through being shelved and dropped and just used as a writer and like, yeah. So I mean, that's possible, but like, she had to fight for her spot. She wanted it that bad. I'm saying
freezing
that
up on me a little bit in the
Nita didn't want it that bad, huh?
You hear me? I say you're freezing up on me a little bit.
Oh shit, man. But yeah, not that Charlie and Vita didn't want it that bad, but like, they didn't have this digital age of where you can put your, and like I said, being put on the record label and you not being able to do shit because they saying we can't release this music right now. Like, they keep doing SZA. Where's my SZA album?
SZA told them people, I'm not putting out, I'm not talking to y'all, I'm not going nowhere, I'm not doing nothing.
TBE.
Leave me alone.
Why women have so much hard of a time on the label? Look at this shit. Look at who we talking about. SZA, Meg. I mean, I'm just saying, she had problems with her label too.
Now she dropped. Did she come back? You okay? You dropped
and then freezing up on me.
I'm not sure why they have some like a hard time on like labels. I would see if it's a thing of you can't get, you know, this sample cleared, you still writing, you trying to pick the best songs for the album, you trying to figure out like what the album is going to be, because if y'all listen to Meg's album, that album is about her healing and like going through the process and the steps of something she probably didn't do before, and now she's taking this album and she's using it to do that. And I was like, I learned that from the song Anxiety. I was like, girl, you got anxiety? I got that too. But I didn't learn that until college. I was like, I didn't know how bad it was until college, but okay, I see
you. That's why I like her album too a lot more. I like the beats too, but I like what she's talking about.
It's personable.
Like I said, the things she done went through, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. And then just talking about, like, just going through the whole album, I was like, I might, but I wish she would have been able to do the rollout of her album because the creator of the Boondocks, Black Dynamite, actually, like, created visuals for her, like, drew up stuff for her.
The anime? She,
yes.
Oh, okay, okay.
He created that for her, and she had deleted all the stuff off her Instagram because I guess they were about to do, like, this really nice rollout. Now, what happened, I'm not sure. But it wasn't, she wasn't able to do it like she wanted to do it.
Okay.
But I listened to her album all the way through. I listened to Beyonce's album all the way through.
Speaking of, I got some music I'm going to bring up today. Y'all let me know if you checked it out. Well, specifically DJ Khaled's new album.
Ooh,
God, I did.
Did you like it?
I'm
going to get into it. I ain't going to get into it yet, but I'm going to get into it.
Okay,
One of the reasons I brought up this, though, as far as the whole Murder, Inc. situation, was that what Irv mentioned as far as him and the way he approached Ashanti as far as them supposedly dating or whatever, going together. And I guess the whole thing is about the way he did it and the way he talked about he did it. Almost sounded like, I ain't going to say he forced himself on her, but he was like, he grabbed her and just kissed her and like,
Well, that's what it sounds like. We're not saying that's what it is, but that's what it sounds like.
Yeah, the way he's making it sound.
Yeah, because you just can't be going up to people, grabbing them, and kissing on them. Sir, there's a thing called consent, and consent is everything. Did she say you could kiss me?
And it's one of those things y'all brought up, the age. It might have been a thing where she was under pressure, like, maybe I don't want to say no because I don't want to feel like this guy, my record,
And that's the thing that a lot of people are talking about. Not just us, it's a lot of people on different platforms.
Oh, yeah.
You know, maybe people who have smaller platforms, you're in the middle, or you have bigger platforms. That's what they're talking about. As in the, you know, you say, you know, you got with her by grabbing her and kissing her, but it's just like, well, how did she feel? We won't know, because I don't think she ever going to say nothing, because
she ain't talking about this, and she don't never need to fuck that nigga.
She is paying him dust. She is paying him dust. And it's just like, you know, that would be me. I pay you dust.
She's going to have a time for her story. And I think she ain't going to mention none of this, by the way. She's going to make sure she save everything as far as the music and the hardships of just getting into the industry.
Yeah. It was like, I would pay you dust. But it's just like the way he's making it seem is when he's talking about her, like I said, it's giving obsessed. And you're not going to be Beyonce fighting a white lady up there and then the white lady fall off because she's hanging on the chandelier. Okay, and it was a nice chandelier, and she broke it. But you're not going to be Beyonce and obsessed, okay? Stop talking about this lady. She don't talk about you. She don't know. She don't know you, okay? And then he was so upset about her walking into the basketball game with Nelly. And it's just like, well, they was around the same age. They liked each other. They can't help it that the people was going to announce them. Don't be
mad. Old man sitting at home.
Don't get mad, get glad, okay? And you was very much married, sir. Let it go.
All right, man, we gotta get out early. I ain't gonna stay on him too much longer. But I did want to kind of talk about him as far as the documentary. Like I said, it is interesting, and it's more so interesting from the standpoint of, I would say, Ja Rule, but it's still interesting with Irv Gotti and just seeing his producer credits. So that part. But let's get out Ja Rule. I mean, just get out Irv Gotti. I want to get out Irv Gotti.
We want Irv to leave us alone. That's what we want to do.
I wish somebody just tell him shut up. Just shut up.
Once again, shout out to everybody that's coming through. I appreciate y'all coming through tonight. And shout out to my co-host and the D, and shout out to our new guest coming through, Rat and Ricardo. Y'all make sure y'all go over and holler at her YouTube page too. You're coming through and watching us live, y'all make sure y'all go over there and subscribe and check out her content. She got some things going on over there. Of course, besides topics, when you come on Uncut This Talk, we do verses. I got a couple verses, interesting verses I got for y'all. Before I go into my first one, have you ever watched Hellraiser?
No.
Well, I'm not doing it yet, but Halloween coming up, and we got a new Hellraiser coming up, and me and the deal probably going to do like this little trilogy thing of the first three Hellraisers, which are my favorites.
Okay.
But besides that, we do have a date for Hellraiser, which is coming out October 7th, straight to Hulu. And the reason I bring that up is I do have a little interesting verses. Hellraiser 1 versus Hellraiser 2. Goriest scene versus. I'm not going to do it yet. My first verses though I'm getting into is dumbest character in the 90s sitcom versus.
Ooh.
Once again, dumbest character in a 90s sitcom versus.
Okay, this is my judge. Okay, I love a good 90s show. Even though I was born in 98, you know, I'm an old soul.
Okay, okay, that's what's up. That's what's up. Okay.
I was raised, well, my auntie said I can't say I was raised by old people. I have to say I was raised by older people. But
you okay. Know, you got an old soul.
Yeah.
I can tell the way you talk.
I was raised by older people. I was always watching the soap operas or Bonanza with them. I'm like Bonanza. I don't even know what that is. But you know what? You watching it? I guess I gotta watch it too. Because at this point, I don't even know how to talk.
I go outside. I'll go in another room or go outside. I ain't watching none of that old ish that they had on TV.
I had to watch
if it wasn't cartoons or Food Network, I'm leaving. Yeah, I watch Wheel of Fortune and like the game mm-hmm. show, but soon as MASH come on.
Oh no, MASH was my show. Okay, that's how I know.
Hell no. I was out the room. I was going to find a piece of paper and draw.
I love MASH. That's how I knew it was. I was like, you hear MASH? Because for some reason, and I say this with George Lopez, and I got like a, now they do YouTube shorts, like they do on TikTok, mm-hmm. but I did it on TikTok, and then I put it on YouTube. I was like, you know, MASH? But this is more about George Lopez. I was like, I love MASH, because MASH always told me, it's time to go to bed. You should have been asleep. Because it don't matter how low you put the volume on the TV. The volume could be on 7. It could be on 7. And MASH just come through.
Now, these naps are just going to bed, like regular going to bed.
No, going to bed. Because MASH, where I was like, they would when they go into syndication, it would be like late night stuff. So it was like after the news they went off, after they even did their little stuff, MASH is about to come on. It's just like, oh, as a kid, I was like, I'm supposed to be in the bed. But once again, the volume could be on 7. The MASH theme song kick in. I'm like, why? We don't have surround sound, okay? Surround sound isn't even a thing right now. And why is it so loud? The same thing with the George Lopez show. Volume on 7.
Okay, let's get into this.
That shit will wake you up out of your sleep.
Thank you for taking me back to my nostalgia days and falling asleep or trying to take a nap and being bored. Once again, dumbest character in the 90s sitcom versus. We doing Martin versus Family Matters.
Okay.
Dumbest character in the 90s sitcom versus.
He wants me, y'all.
Pam, the man is sick. Not desperate.
Okay, yeah. You know what we need up in here? We need some tunes. Let me turn this radio on. Oh! Oh!
My bad.
I was upset. We drive all the way across town to see the Prince of Tides, and there wasn't one bit of surfing. We should have went to see JFK.
Oh, you mean JFK.
I know how it's spelled.
It's
giving Prindle. It is giving Prindle from Sweet Life is like it's a Prindle.
Oh, once again, dumbest character in the 90s sitcom versus. And it's not being rude or anything, man. These characters was made dumb on
they
purpose.
Was this written was
writing
to be dumb.
For the show. Of course, Cole versus Waldo.
Okay, so I did review the reunion that the Martin cast did, which they had a beautiful, tribute to Tommy and, like, had his actual wife and kids there as well. It was a beautiful tribute. But I was, like, watching the show like I did and then looking at the reunion in the way that Carl, who played Cole, which, come to find out, the themes, like the theme song for Martin, that's Carl singing or doing whatever. That's him singing Martin's. But the character of Cole, I was like, Cole, in a sense, wasn't like, he was dumb, but he wasn't as dumb as people like to think, because, you know, he had, like, even though it was a Pacer, he had his own car.
No.
He was dumb, but he was a low functioning human being,
but he wasn't like not idiotic.
Was he idiotic? No, it would be like, you know how you meet those people who are just so innocent to certain things in the world that it comes off as stupidity? Like, they so innocent to certain things in the world, and you just, like, you know, that's not what you do, or how, like, the heart monitor situation. Everybody in the room knew it was a heart monitor, right?
He said it was a radio, and he was dancing to it. Seriously.
But that was what I was getting to. I was like, everyone in the room except for him knew it was a heart monitor. And y'all allowed him to go over there.
He moved quick. They was thinking Tommy's still on the bed. They paying attention to Tommy. They ain't paying attention to his goofy ass going over there turning on the heart monitor, the AKA radio.
He turned the switch and then have him doing one of these.
And when he turned it off, he still was going.
Just like, yes, he was dumb, but he had his moments. Like, he would say things that didn't make sense, but really made sense if you thought about it, versus Waldo, who, once again, JFK, that's how you say it. It's not an acronym it's an acronym for the man's name, but it's not an acronym where it is. I know how to spell it. We know how to spell it too, but you don't know how to say it. He had a few moments where, you know, it was clarity. When he went off on Eddie about the whole drinking situation and how he didn't like how Eddie was treating him when he was drunk. But it was like, Waldo, for the longest time, was a follower of the bullies. Then he became friends with Eddie. But in no way, shape, or form did that man ever get smarter. He did.
I mean, was Eddie that smart, though? Was Eddie that smart?
You mean Cole?
No. If Waldo became friends with Eddie and he didn't get smarter, was Eddie that smart?
No, because Eddie had Steve doing his homework. It was the blind leading the blind. It's dumb and dumber.
Damn! I'm going with Waldo.
I'm going with Waldo.
You broke that down the way you did, then it's almost like you gotta go with Waldo, but I'm going with Cole. Waldo said Jeff, like, all right, but a heart monitor and you dancing and you still dancing after. No, I'm going with Cole Martin.
I mean,
Nadia,
Waldo was idiotic. I was going, regardless to her synopsis of why, I was still going with Waldo because that nigga's dumb.
Listen, I was gonna have to go with Waldo for the simple fact that, based off the people surrounding him, like, you didn't learn nothing from Steve. At least Cole was learning from the people around him, and he did give us Rhythm Spoons, and that scene was hilarious, and I always go back to it. Waldo was just stupid for no reason. Where is Waldo's brain? Is my question. Okay.
By the way, both of these are loyal friends,
but, you know,
not reliable.
The mall is open, but ain't nobody really shopping all up and through there. It's a few people, not a lot.
They malls ain't even got escalators or elevators.
You better start listening and stop playing.
I wouldn't go to that mall.
Okay. One of the first topics that I was gonna jump into, but I wanted to jump into the Murder Inc. thing. Had my boy Brillo on here because I know he really not no comic book fan. Are y'all comic book fans as far as the movies?
Yes.
Okay. The Batman. This is one of my favorite ones came out this year. Very dark version of the Batman. Matt Reeves movie. We got a little bit of an update because there's been a lot of scrapping going on at Warner Brothers with recent movies. Batgirl not coming out. Shazam and Aquaman being delayed next year. But as far as Batman 2, we got an update as far as writers that are going to be coming on. And that's good news because people was wondering, since this hadn't been greenlit yet, are we actually going to get a new Batman from Matt Reeves or whatever? So this is good news. We all got the writers. Matt Reeves is coming back. But not only that, Matt Reeves got like a little overall deal as far as a big deal with Warner Brothers, pretty much putting him in charge of not only maybe comic book movies, but other content for Warner Brothers. Mm-hmm. By the way, this is the same guy who did the Planet of the Apes movies with Caesar. I think he did not the first one, but Dawn of the Planet of the Apes and War for Planet of the Apes. He also did Cloverfield, and he did Let Me In, the vampire movie.
I'm going to be honest. I didn't watch none of the Planet of the Apes.
None of the what?
I didn't watch none of the Planet of the Apes movies. I was like...
Oh, the new ones? Well, not really new, but the recent ones.
Mm-mm, I don't watch them.
They're worth it. I'm telling you.
Here's my thing. I was like, let them do it. Some of y'all need to get got. I'm sorry. Some of y'all just be out here messing with them. Like, you could have left them alone. You went over there, messed with them, brought them back, did what you did. Now they smarter than you, and now they ready to get you because, you know, you playing games. So I was like, you know, I didn't watch it. At least it's good to hear that Batman got a writer. And like,
right, did you watch this one? The one that came out this year?
I saw portions of it. It's kind of like, I'm actually going to have to go back and watch it because I do have HBO Max, but it's just like, it's kind of hard for like Robert.
Man, you better hurry up. HBO Max ain't going to be around too much longer out here.
Yeah, I was like, well, Robert, it's really hard because the last time I really watched the movie, which you saw, it was Twilight. So it was like, I got to skirt away from you being dude from Twilight and the fact that I don't like that man to you being Batman.
He ain't Twilight in this. And he done a lot of indie movies that kind of separate him from Twilight. Yeah. He's a good actor.
Then you being Batman, but then like me and Batman, even though I don't know that man like that, I don't really fool with him because I felt like if I had an option of, you know, moving to, you know, like somewhere and then Gotham, I would pick this somewhere where I don't know the places. It don't have a name. I would move to Gotham because Bruce Wayne, aka Batman, hoards all the wealth. And then be fighting off, not even fighting, be like breaking people's backs as they trying to put boxes on the truck so they can make just a little bit of money to pay their rent.
That's not Batman. Who you talking about the Punisher? Not the Batman. You talking about the Punisher.
Now you know Batman. He see like people blowing.
Watch the Zack Snyder version. That was been that. Nah, not that Batman.
Not this Batman.
I like Batman on that too, but still.
But I'm glad because the most recent thing I saw when it came to whatever Discovery and Warner Brothers or Warner Brothers Discovery is doing is basically diversity is out the window and a lot of stuff is getting cut, just cutting it up. And it's just like, I don't like this because it's a lot of good shows on HBO Max. I can't do it, but I'm glad they got a writer. I'm glad the writer got a deal and maybe they're going to take the story in a like build off the story because I know one of the things that what was the character? I think the Riddler.
Yeah. They had a couple cameos at the end, but the main villain was the Riddler in this one.
Yeah.
Very sadistic.
Yeah. And the Riddler and like how they set the website up for everything to get riddles and all that different stuff. I was like, I like the way y'all doing it. But if y'all trying to become DC Studios, let it go.
Nadia, you didn't ever finish this either, did you? I remember you said you wanted to start it.
I watched
it,
the whole thing.
Oh, okay. Did you enjoy it? But not like I enjoyed this one of my favorite movies, but did you like it for what it was as far as being a Batman movie?
I liked it for what it was. I probably need to go back and watch it because I know for sure I fell asleep on one part. It was towards the end, and I just kept falling asleep. But I don't blame the movie. I blame me. I was tired.
Yeah, it's a crime thriller because it's more of like an investigation movie.
It's dark, so you know, it should be dark on the screen.
The Dark Knight is my favorite still to this day, as far as the Christopher Nolan one with Heath Ledger's Joker.
Oh, yeah. That's a good one. That's always a good one. I don't like the Ben Affleck one. I don't like the, listen, I love me some George Clooney, but that Batman, that wasn't it.
No.
That wasn't it.
You said George Clooney?
When he was Batman?
She said that wasn't it. She said that was not it.
I was trying to get my Batmans right. I was like, I'm not a big fan of Ben Affleck, but Dash is like, oh, you know, after he said some things about his ex situation. But the George Clooney version, that wasn't it. I don't know what y'all was doing. I don't know who signed off on that. I don't judge. I'm judging a little bit, but that wasn't
it. You gotta understand what time period that was, because they had a lot of success coming off of that Batman with Jim Carrey as a Riddler. Like, people liked that movie. Mm-hmm. That was a big movie. So they was like, we need to get more sillier then. Let's go even above and beyond over the top with this next one. Y'all went too far. Way too far. But yeah, comment section on how y'all feeling about the Batman getting writers. I'm pretty sure we're not going to get this anytime soon. But I'm not sure if this is the same writers that was on the first one. I think it is. I think he was kind of a co-writer, though. Because I think Matt Reeves was majority writer as far as that first film go. But yes, the writer is named Mattson Tomlin. He did contribute to some of the first film. So it's going to be interesting to see where they go with this one as far as this new one.
Listen, I got my laptop right here. Even though it's acting up in some ways, I can just look it up.
What's his name?
Mattson?
Mattson Tomlin. Next thing I wanted to hop into, another topic before I jump back over to Versus. We got a new rapper in town. Got a new MC in town. FN Mecca? I think that's the name, FN Mecca?
Mecca. I don't know which one they want to go by. I never took the time to care.
I mean, if you wanted to get signed, go to GTA and play. You may get you a record deal now.
Get you a play. Sorry, he was an uncredited writer on the Batman.
Oh, okay. As far as Mattson Tomlin.
Mm-hmm. And he did movies he'd written, Project Power with Jamie Foxx. Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Little Fish. I never watched that movie. And some movie called Mother / Android.
I'm definitely interested to see what his take going to be as far as coming in, because it looked like Matt Reeves going to try to give him a little bit more to do than what he did in that first one. But yes, new rapper we got. FN Mecca. AI rapper. I did not know anything about this. Shout out to my cousin Deal for sending me this. I didn't know anything about this. I never heard about him. I ain't never seen anything about this. What's going on? And he got a record deal, by the way.
Yeah.
And he has been dropped.
Yes. Which is ironic. You create an AI rapper so that it's less controversial of a person and they still get canceled. Damn. The world
he's not real, but he got canceled.
Yeah. He's not real, but he got canceled. My thing about it, though, is it's funny because I was like, all these people that's like subscribed to him or whatever, like following him, I was like, they bots. It's bots following bots. Right? Like, because the whole, like, really, if I never would have sent you this, would you ever have seen this? No, because nobody cares and nobody knew who the fuck this person was. AI person, metaverse rapper.
I ain't got time to be listening to goddamn rapping RoboCop. Like, I'm good on it. Man,
I saw this. I didn't click on it because I saw the picture and I was like, I don't know what that is. I don't want to know what that is, and I'm leave. I saw it on a Shade Room. I was looking for something, and I saw that, and I was like, maybe this is a sign I shouldn't even be looking through the Shade Room. So I'm gonna just leave. They're doing a lot of stuff with like the metaverse and, you know, AI, because that's the way they think people are gonna go. People be clubbing in the metaverse, they be having court in the metaverse. I've seen it on Cleo Thomas. If y'all have ever watched the movie Holes,
Shia Book.
Or Mixed Mike and Roll Bounce.
Yeah, and Roll Bounce.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Cleo Thomas, the actor, he games a lot on Twitch, so he has like the, you know, whatever it is to go into the metaverse. And we saw him go clubbing in the metaverse, and then people were talking about how they be going to court and all this different stuff, be having concerts, be having house parties, all that stuff. So I was like, oh, okay, makes sense. But I didn't know y'all built like an actual like robot.
What's that movie, Demolition Man? Because like now they talking about virtual. Now they talking about like virtual sex and stuff like that. Like, bruh, so they got virtual models. So it's like this girl, her name is, I forgot her name because I don't care because they're AI, you know, whatever.
Have you ever seen the joint Game Over? I think this was called Game Over.
I know what you're talking about. It's Stephen King? Steven Spielberg. I can't say his name right. I think that was his. It's one of them damn Stevens. But anyway, it's a girl. She got a PacSign contract. Like, she's like a model with them. And she's a AI.
I have not.
Bruh. I'm like, so who does this money go to? Did the money go to the creators and the people that are digitally controlling her? Or like, who getting paid from these are digital influencers. Why are you following these people and telling them that they're pretty? What the fuck? This is a rope.
This is like
a cartoon.
My thing is with this, you know, this robot rapper, this AI rapper, whatever type of rapper this, listen to, you know, the technology that is listening. I don't want to talk about y'all people like that, but I don't know this man or this person. But who is the money going to? Is it
Shout out, Tony. Hello. Appreciate you coming through, bro.
Did Capitol Records like throw money into the robot? Then the robot gets built, they sign a robot, be looking for people to produce and write for the robot, and then the robot got dropped because it wasn't doing what it was supposed to do to fulfill its contract, or did somebody else build it and then was trying to get signed that way? Like, y'all said that the robot got dropped, but y'all ain't telling me who created the robot, who signed the deal.
You can go look that up. I forgot, but I think, I want to say it's an Asian dude. Like somebody created them and made them look. The problem is the way it looks.
Even some of the things they're saying. But ain't it a black guy that's voicing them? It's a black rapper that's voicing them. Well, yes. Not a black rapper, but the guy behind
them. It's a black man that's voicing them. So the rapper said, first of all, why are you talking about street shit? What street? The mean streets of the metaverse, sir?
The mean street of San Andreas. What you mean?
No.
What you mean?
No.
Los Santos.
What's the green? Look, he got the green hair. Yo, this is the game. Grove Street.
Verde Street.
He got beef on Twitch.
Lord. It's just like, y'all will do anything. Listen, okay, I guess y'all signed the robot rapper is what I'm calling him. I mean, there are shows with, like, people who have met in the metaverse and they've been dating in the metaverse and then they finally meet each other. Like, there are shows like that out there. But they're not trying to rap. Let's be clear on something. I feel like y'all trying to go the AI way with the rappers, because the rappers nowadays, like we talked about earlier into the show, they're being independent, because they can put their money into them, and then they reap all the benefits after they pay who needs to be paid. It's not I got to break off the label, I got to break off the wardrobe, the makeup,
the hairstylist, make a writer. Not to mention how much you save in making videos, because it's all digital. Like, you just paying people to. So who's buying this shit? Who's listening to this shit?
Somebody
cares.
Somebody got their attention because they signed. He got there because he got like over a billion streams or something on TikTok. As far as the LL makeup,
there are not him, but in the other bots.
Wasn't on my For You page. Wasn't on my For You page. I forgot to mention Glorilla. FNF, her song.
Yeah,
that whole video in a parking lot. Wasn't nobody shelling out a whole bunch of money for that video? Did that whole video in a parking lot. A lot of these artists these days, especially when the label gives them creative control over what they want to do, they basically be saving the label a lot of money, because it's just, which is like, when the label gives them creative control over them and their music, let's be clear, these artists are saving y'all money. They're not going all crazy with the videos and all this stuff. And I learned that from
marketing and all of it. So you're putting it behind the budget.
Yeah. I learned that from a, not this person. I learned it from a boy band that I follow called Pretty Much. They were signed to Simon Cowell and then his label. But when the label went under for him, they got signed to like Warner Brothers, like a subset of Warner Brothers. And then they have a lot of creative control over like their music. Like they were, by the end of the time with Simon, they were producing, writing, doing all that stuff for their music. But now they have like, I think 95% creative control over everything. And they were talking about how, you know, they'll meet with their team about videos and they'll have the budget and it's a nice chunk of change. And they'd be like, well, we could do this for the cheap and make it still look good, but we could do this for a lot cheaper so we're not spending all this money, and then put the money into other things. Like you said, marketing, advertising.
That's what Chloe and Halle was doing. That's why Chloe started learning how to do produce, because she was like, it saves money. Like, but then they don't pay her, which is so fucking crazy. They'll go pay the producer. Like, if she be like, I want Pharrell, they'll go pay Pharrell. But if she does it herself, they don't pay her.
That's
Pharrell being a veteran.
That's
been in the industry so long, you can't really railroad.
It don't matter, but if I'm producing my own music, I don't get my producer money. Like, it's not like she asked. Like, you know, you get what I'm saying. Are you saving the record label money, but then they don't pay you for your service?
But
like,
here's the thing.
But you are paid.
The thing about like, even if you're not getting a producer pay, I think they should. Like, if they're going to produce their own stuff, they should still get the producer pay, because they are producing it and they're writing it. They get into the booth and, like, you know, recording it, whether they're rapping, they singing, whatever they're doing, or if they just playing instruments. But what I do like is if she's going to produce her own music, or if somebody's going to produce their own music and they're writing their own music, give them the credits. So then, when the royalty checks start rolling in, after we and divvied up what we're supposed to divvy up between, you know, the artists and the writers and the label, I'm still going to get a nice, you know, chunk of that, because not only did I produce it, I wrote it, and I performed it. And
you got to make sure you dive in as far as royalties. I always make sure that check coming in.
And then it's I'm also going to make money off of performing it, which a lot of people, like, I do think
that's where they make all their money.
Yeah. They make touring and performing. I think, and then if you have, like, okay, so talking about Meg, she took the slogan, or, like, you know, Hot Girl Summer, trademarked it, so then she could put, or Hottie, she could put it on stuff and then make money that way for merch.
So, speaking of Meg, would an AI twerking rapper work?
No.
Let it break.
No. No. It went. Who's subscribing to that? You could go watch shit like that for free. And
that's
other
what I'm
sites.
Saying. Just
like,
even with this. This
and who's
you think nobody ain't going to pay
support?
For that, though?
Nobody's. Here's the thing. nobody's paying for it. Because if it's in the metaverse, you just buy the stuff, like the equipment, like the, you know.
That's
the
almost gospel. Like saying, who gonna pay for OnlyFans when you go watch it for free?
People do it.
That's,
I mean, because if you want to see that particular person and you cannot get it nowhere else, you'll pay for it.
Yeah.
Period. And but, it's about that particular person. It's not about.
That's true.
You just want to see somebody naked. You want to see somebody naked, you can Google that shit quick.
If an artist
don't if they don't tour, they don't eat. And you can't sit, you can't sit back and wait on royalty checks. Chloe says she make more money off of being an influencer than she does actually singing.
And that's depending on what type of contract you sign, too.
Yeah.
The music, you don't make music even T-Pain said it. He make more money from gaming than he ever made doing music. You don't make money from music like that, period.
What is it?
It's true.
It's a passion.
Not even like, not trying to skirt off of music, but Dante Bosco, if you've ever watched, like, he was Rufio in Hook. Mm-hmm. He was Zuko in...
yes, that voice.
And American
Dragon.
American Dragon. And people... Yeah,
I don't know who y'all talking
about. American Dragon. To this day, people be like, American Dragon? Y'all...
Bruh, that's a slip-on show.
It really is. Like, American Dragon, when did y'all watch this? I was like, y'all wasn't watching that.
No, he just left.
I was like, y'all wasn't watching Disney Channel at like 2, 3 o'clock in the morning when, you know, American Dragon, Dave the Barbarian,
Brandy
and Mr. Whiskers, Braceface.
I've watched cartoons way past the years that I was supposed to. Mm-hmm. I was one of the... This is the weird shit that people don't know about me. I watched cartoons in high school. I tried to tell somebody that shit, and they was like, you weird as fuck. And I was like, what the fuck ever?
No. it's weird that you was watching cartoons in high school, but now people in their 40s and their 50s, y'all watching Adventure Time, and then gonna be one talk to me about Adventure Time, but it's just like, why are you just making fun of me for watching cartoons in high school? Get out my face with this. You know, I maybe talk to you next week about Adventure Time, but I don't want to hear it because you was just making fun of me. But going back to Dante Bosco, he does this thing called a residual check lottery on his TikTok. And he be having all the checks there in the envelopes, and he be like, he weighs them on what he gonna have for dinner that night. And he was like, I'm either gonna have Taco Bell or I'm gonna have a nice steak. Let's see what's in this check. And one of the checks after taxes was like 79 cent. And I was like, that's not even worth, like, the check is not even worth the money that, like, the paper that it was printed on.
The paper, yeah, the stamp was worth more than the damn.
I was like,
check. Yeah, the homie, touring, merchandising, and most revenue.
Yep.
Depending on the contract, though, if you find a 360, all that touring and merchandising and revenue going to the label. Depending on what type of contract you sign.
Yeah.
You got to watch out what you sign.
All you getting is that advance, and that's it.
That's why they say you got to really watch out what you sign.
And then you got to pay that back.
Lord.
That advance, loan.
Oh, God.
Just call it a loan.
You have to...
Just call it what it is. It's a loan. You're not going to get this. It's a loan. And it was like, this is, I don't have loans. It's why I'm still paying for a master's degree right now, because I was paying out of pocket. I didn't take no loans because I was like, you're not about to get me. No. I'd rather have a payment plan set up. Me and these loans, I'm good. Because call it what it is. An advance is a loan.
Mm-hmm.
The homie, I don't know nothing about the Degrassi.
Oh, my
$12.
Y'all let me know, though. FM Mecca, are y'all planning on listening to his new mixtape or album when it dropped? Let me know. So we're going to jump back down here to verses.
Okay.
Best emotional singing in a movie versus.
Ooh.
One more time. Best singing, emotional singing in a movie versus. Color Purple versus Five Heartbeats. What?
Wait, which scene from the Five Heartbeats?
I'm going to play it.
You got to watch.
You got to play. Once again, best emotional singing scene in the movie versus. I can't get along.
see, Daddy, sinners have soul too.
Color Purple versus Five Heartbeats. I had to do those two scenes. It just so happened that they be in church.
That ain't no coincidence.
It just so happened these two individuals that's coming back into the church having to be extra sinners.
Like, that ain't coincidental. This is like a trope throughout black media. I'm sorry.
Drake fussing the chick online, homie.
You know...
what is you doing? You can't do that. Nah, homie. You can't do that. You said Color Purple. Now you said a Five Heartbeat.
You better pick a side and stay there.
I get it though. Take your time. Take your time.
I'm gonna go with the Five Heartbeats. I tell you why. Because last time we seen Eddie, he was outside scrouching, talking about nights like this, I wish raindrops would fall. He just outside begging for somebody to help him, and they ain't helping him. They like, I don't know this man. Security, come get him. Come get him.
At the same time, my girl Suge Avery, Color Purple, she was just coming off of that binge out here singing and selling.
Should be okay. I read the book. Sugar be okay. And then the last time we saw...
Sugar be okay? What? Sugar did she have okay. That thing? She had it.
Sugar will be okay. Eventually, Sugar went on to marry a young man and got Celie up out of there. And then Celie went on to have a nice life after, you know, she left that man and told him, till you do right by me, everything you touch gonna suffer. But going back to Eddie, we got Eddie coming back. He off in drugs. He looked like he didn't got his life together. Last time we saw Baby Doll, she left Eddie because he was starting to get on that stuff, and it's just like, well, I'm not gonna stand around and let you kill yourself. Not gonna do that. You're not gonna listen to me. I'm not gonna sit here and watch you do it. So then we see Eddie singing, and then Baby Doll pop up, and it's just like, girl, last time I saw you, you had like this bob. It was black. I didn't like it, but now you rocking the green. You look real nice. Then we got a choir boy leading a church in the choir. And the last time we saw a choir boy, the whole damn group was breaking up because JT was messing with Doug
Plummer. And choir boy was out here singing.
Yeah. And I was like, everybody finally got back together. I was like, everybody finally got back together. Duck up in the church, choir boy, Eddie, Baby Doll. Everybody finally
got back together. All that being said, Suge, her daddy, her father, her pastor, disowned her, and she come in there just singing to him. See, Daddy, even sinners, I gotta go with Suge Avery, Color Purple.
Why is she selling pocketbooks?
Yep, yes, she was, and that's what I mean. Dumpsy had that thing, that disease, that killer.
What is it called? The package? What is
the nasty one?
Sorry, I didn't went to the closet.
They call that the nasty woman's disease.
Bro, come on now, dog. Come on, man.
Why is this gonna be the nasty woman? It could be whatever nasty man gave it to her.
But hey, that's what happened when we out here in pocketbooks, and guess who didn't care? Andy Glover. You didn't give up. I'm with it. Mr. didn't care. Mr. Cool. I gotta go with Suge Avery though. Hey, but you, who y'all was choosing? Best emotional singing in the movie versus?
Eddie, it's not a conspiracy. I was going with the Five Heartbeats.
Y'all both going with Eddie.
Yeah.
Oh, Eddie Kane.
He
got redemption. He got the redemption that he so desperately wanted and needed, and he found it in the Lord. I personally would have been okay with it if you found it in the Lord, your ancestors, and a good black therapist, but you know, it was the times. So you found it in the Lord.
Yeah.
And maybe your ancestors. But if it was like today, if it was now, and Eddie was a real person, I would have been told him, sir, now I can't put you in rehab because I ain't got the money, but I can help you find you a good black therapist because you need it. And y'all know he felt guilty about Red putting the head out on, you know, the manager.
See, right then and there, that's when Eddie might have had to get took out.
Which pushed him, but he didn't, in the sense of he felt guilty about it, he probably felt guilt because he didn't expect, you know, him just speaking to the man for that to happen.
That's the man that put y'all on. You got him killed. No, Eddie had to go. Eddie should have been gone. I'm sorry. I was watching the movie, Eddie should have been gone, for my opinion.
But shout out to
this guy. This is my man. Here. He put us on. He sacrificed. His wife is a widow now.
Shout out to Miss Diane Carroll for smacking him in the church and then putting her glasses back on, like, not moving along.
Coming there sobbing and shit, faking.
The loudest person at the funeral is the one who did terrible by the person who was alive.
Shout out to Red. My office hours are from. But y'all going with Eddie Kane? I'm going with Suge Avery.
Is that how Suge Knight, what they say, he was hanging people over balconies? Did he learn that from Red?
Boy, if you don't...
Alleged. Over balconies. And I just want to know, allegedly speaking, did you learn that from Red? Because he did hang that man over a balcony.
Hey, without doing it, we wouldn't have got no death row.
Before that, though.
But,
that might have been made before this.
I think
this was made before that situation. I think.
Like I said, without that situation allegedly happening, we would have not gotten death row. Because that's how he got the punch. He
might have got his inspiration from Red. Think about the name, Red.
Okay, let's move on. Because you get real upset. Let's move on.
And that's on Piru. But next verses. Before we get into New Music Friday, I'm going to do another verses right quick.
Okay.
Funniest shootout scene in the movie verses. Once again, funniest shootout scene in the movie verses. We got Harlem Nights versus Naked Gun 33. Well, Naked Gun 3, my bad.
Not 33.
That's what...
It's called Naked Gun 33.
Okay.
Once again, funniest shootout scene versus Harlem Nights versus Naked Gun. I'm going to just say Naked Gun.
It's a lawnmower that security guard.
Yes, you can't do that in 2022. That was back in the day. You can't do all.
The baby's just flying everywhere.
See, the baby's flying would probably be more acceptable than the gardener coming down the stairs. Honestly, in today, I'm telling.
The security guard trying to pull the gun out the. It's not, that's not a side holster, but whatever the holster was, and just like try to pull it but can't get it.
Shout out to Harlem Nights, man. I love that scene.
Man, what the hell?
Harlem Nights, he talking about, don't take off his hat, hit beat people with it, talking about, don't shoot him no more. Don't shoot him no more.
I see you all.
And then turn around and start shooting people. How you gonna tell me what to stop doing stuff and then you turn around and do it?
Who y'all got? Funniest shootout scene in the movie versus Harlem Nights versus Naked Gun.
Harlem Nights.
What?
I bet you y'all get y'all saying Naked Gun was funny, was just stupid, like retarded.
It was like,
Yeah, okay. I mean, picking up change while shooting.
Yeah, it was like a quarter pound.
And then shoot the security guard, but nobody was getting hit. I was like, this don't make no sense.
Nah, yeah, nobody was getting hit. Me. I gotta go with Naked Gun then. I gotta be the opposite.
Oh,
I was laughing at that shit. Why? And that's a classic movie to me. Guilty pleasure back in the day. That was a guilty pleasure to me. So I gotta go with Naked Gun. OJ Simpson. Like I said, I think it's more so watching a full movie than that scene in particular with Steve.
Okay. Don't go with Harlem Nights.
I understand.
I love me some.
All right. New Music Friday. We got DJ Khaled. We got Offset Solo. And speaking of Offset, Migos just so happened to drop a single too. Quavo and Takeoff.
Nope.
So,
that's Migos now.
No Offset.
Nah, it's Uncle Neff and Offset. Yeah, Offset got his own little song.
Okay.
He going solo. Speaking of Offset, we're going to kind of have to talk about Offset, man. He got some things going on out here.
Mm.
Got a little problem going on with QC. Trying to be solo, and QC wants some credits after he already done paid his way out of this supposed contract. I got some issues with this, man, especially with this being a Black-owned record label.
Because I had a thought about this, because we see a lot of the Black artists going through this, and then, you know,
not only Black artists, Black labels, Birdman, P. Diddy,
Black labels, Black artists, and then, you know, the people who are head of the label or work for the label, or maybe a manager, a publicist, or whoever, feel like, well, I made you. And in my mind, it's just like, well, if you made them and you got them to where they are, why can't you go and make another one? Or, you know, why can't you do for them?
Oh, Jay-Z tell somewhat.
And do it to, like, put it on yourself and then make yourself be bigger than them. That's right. You don't got that type of talent. If he already bought his way out of the contract, or the alleged contract, or however the situation is set up, he's already bought.
I'm pretty sure they had a contract. They was like one of their first groups as far as QC, okay. As far as the Migos.
If he's already bought himself out of the contract and money has been handed off, he didn't pay whatever the rest of the contract, whatever the rest of the deal was.
Everything.
And got clear of everything and all this stuff. You don't get no credits. That's like me being in a singing group and, you know, I lead a group. I didn't, you know, paid out the contract, or I broke the contract, or I said I'm out. We didn't already squashed everything. Legal has already taken care of it. And then my group maybe 5 months later puts out some music. I can't get no credit off of that. I was a part of the group, but I wasn't a part of the group when they put the music out. Do you know why? Because I didn't write on it. I didn't produce on it. I didn't go in the booth and record it. Hell, I didn't even put input or nothing. I ain't even talking to these people.
It's just kind of crazy for me because Migos are still with QC. And Offset is separated, being that they family. But I feel like this is way deeper as far as business-wise. It's so much different things going on.
We won't understand. Stuff.
But
it do, like, literally, it sound like some Destiny's Child stuff. Like, what is going on?
And it could be.
It's just upsetting to me because, and I'm saying this from looking on the outside. I don't understand everything that's going on. Mm-hmm. As far as with P, as far as the big man behind QC, it's like, this is one of your first people that y'all brung in. It's like, not only if this guy already paid the money to get out of his contract, if y'all are black, you one of the most biggest black-owned labels out here now, QC. Lil Baby, one of the biggest artists in the world. I mean, City Girls, all of this going on. It's like, why not let this guy go be his own man as far as being his own boss? Because that's got to seem like that's what Offset's trying to do, be his own boss.
Are the City Girls still signed to them?
Yeah, they still signed to QC. And my whole thing, like I said, is just the whole story behind everything. It's always the Birdman's as far as, oh, he's not playing the artist in this and the third. The P. Diddy's. He's not paying the artist this and the third. And it's always going back to these majority black-owned labels. You always hear about the regular labels, you know, the Interscopes, Warner Brothers and all of that, not playing their artists or whatever. But I got an issue when it comes to these black-owned labels not getting their other black artists right. The only thing I say is maybe some of these labels started off young. You know, these guys coming from the streets and everything, they might not be all the way engaged or familiar with the business aspect of everything. So everybody is still learning is what I'm trying to say. Everybody's probably still trying to learn somewhat.
I think in the sense of they probably did start off young, you have to look at the... Because now I didn't pull up the roster. Because now I got to figure out what's going on. But they started this...
It's a lot of them out. It's a lot of people.
They started the label back in 2013. So...
Migos. First group.
The label is still considered like a baby in a sense. So it's just like, I get y'all started off young. But when you have groups that have helped put you on a map, like... We talk about two groups that help put them on a map, Migos and City Girls.
City Girls came way late on. Migos put them on. If anything, Migos should damn near be somewhat a share as far as QC. You don't talk about QC without the Migos. You don't even know who QC is if the Migos is not becoming who they are as far as the popularity and the music and what they doing.
I didn't learn about QC.
Not taking nothing from P or QC, by the way, as far as Coach Daniel.
I didn't hear anything about QC until I started listening to the City Girls and somebody mentioned QC. And I said, now who QC? And then I went and looked it up. But you have looking at the artists, you have Migos, Lil Baby, Lil Yachty. I don't know this person. City Girls, Lakia. That's another one. She out here putting out music too.
Yep, she is. I've seen her. She's getting around.
I don't know. Bankroll Freddy. Y'all know who Bankroll Freddy is?
A little bit. He's not really out there like that in the right now, though, as far as the popularity of the other artists.
Yeah, I was like, there's some of these people that was like, no, I don't really know them like that. But then you
go underground.
Yeah, so then you have the, you know, now they have a section that says notable former acts. Offset, Rich the Kid.
And these are guys that bought their way out of their deal. Rich the Kid was one of the first ones because he started his own label. Probably Flipper the Skipper or Skipper the Flipper of him. He was a part of QC.
Mm-hmm. So it's just like, why is it that... Hold on. Migos? Somebody updated it?
I just think it should be a situation where you should be allowing Offset to be his own man if y'all have that type of relationship and you see where y'all both done came from and you see the environment y'all done came from. P being who he is, especially an older individual, it's like, let's sit down and work this out together. Me and you came into this together, as far as him and Migos, Offset.
But then you have to ask the question, what was the outcome of the lawsuit that the Migos brought against QC?
And that's what I'm saying about us being on the outside, not really knowing everything. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of things we probably don't know.
Because it's just like, based off the Wikipedia, it don't say he out of the group. It just say, you know.
But see, that's the difference. Was they signed as a group or just a group? Or was they signed as a group and individual solo artists? If they weren't signed as individual solo artists, then he should be done. He should be good because he's a solo artist, not Migos no more.
Hold on. Who am I thinking that did this? Maybe it might have been and maybe this is just like, is it probably a far out there thought, the way the Wu-Tang Clan did their thing?
That's a good,
where the group was signed to this like smaller label. But just because the group was signed to a smaller label and how like contracts and all that stuff worked out.
That's different too, because RZA structured that as far as him. And RZA, you know, he looked after them immediately after they got their deal. Mm-hmm. He made sure they had solo deals.
Yeah. And I was like watching the show and just like watching the documentaries for Wu-Tang Clan. RZA like learned from when he originally got signed the first time and didn't go nowhere. So then you had them signed.
Let me be honest with myself. Before you finish, I'm going to have to cut you off. RZA was a way, if I'm not mistaken, RZA is a lot younger than P as far as before he started QC. Maybe. I could be wrong. I could be wrong. But I'm saying that RZA didn't technically start a record label either, though. I got to make sure I mention that because Q started Q as far as from QC. I mean, P from QC. He started a label. He wasn't even rapping. But I just feel like RZA kind of had that knowledge and was early on it before he even got the full-on deal. And that's why he was able to make those deals for like Method Man, Raekwon, and Ghostface.
I looked it up. RZA is 53. He is 40.
Oh, so RZA is older than him. I was wrong. My bad.
Well, once he should be. Child, he not 40. He 41. He got the same. He was born the same year as my mama. She 41. He 41. Quit playing with me, Wiki. Not Wiki. Quit playing with me, Google. But it could have been a situation like that where maybe when the group signed, they signed as a group and not as, maybe they had this kind of deal like that. Maybe.
So that means Offset has his rights to be going solo and not have any credits from the label on his solo material.
Because I looked at, like, when I was looking at the roster, it didn't say, and then I looked at if, you know, because normally Wikipedia is on this stuff, like they have people updating it. If he would have been out of like a former member of the group, it says he's still a member of the group. So it might have been a situation of how Wu-Tang did it. The group is signed to a label, but us as individuals, we not signed to that same label. And maybe he bought his way out of that contract to just be like, I want to maybe do music independently. I want to go sign with somebody else, but I'm not still.
That's right, though.
I'm still in this group. Because we saw it happen. It was like Method Man was over here.
Because ODB wasn't even with Def Jam. He got his own little solo deal at another label.
Yeah. What RZA set up. ODB is over here. RZA is over there. Ghostface is over there. It was a lot of them. I can't name everybody, okay? It's a lot of them. I know my music history, but off the top of the dome, I can't name everybody. But everybody was everywhere else. But it's just like, do right by your artists. And, you know, we wouldn't have to have headlines like this. Don't get upset if they want to have different management or maybe they want to do something else. This is what happens with people, not just artists, but people in general. As we get older, we start to change. And for artists, like, or a content creator, whatever you want to call it, like, I'm a creative. And my, like, the stuff that I create, it's my art, and I'm sensitive about it. Shout out to Erykah Badu. I'm an artist, and I'm sensitive about my shit. So you got to realize, as people get older, things start to change with their art. Maybe they want to do something else. Maybe they have a different ear for music than, you know, what's going on this side. Maybe they want to do different stuff, and if you're not allowing them to do said stuff with you, then they do. And you see this in, like, a lot of the biographies they do for like the artists of the 90s and the 80s or the unsungs, that they either started to get older and change and wanted to change up their music and the label, and the people wasn't having it, so then they start acting out or they buy their way out of their contracts and different stuff like that. It's just like, if you don't allow your people to grow and change and be a like a sounding board, a shoulder, person that they could be like, here, listen to this, what do you think, and give them honest opinions, and you're not trying to be like,
just people, I just think they need options, and that's what I think Offset needs. He needs his options. So I want y'all to let me know in the comment section how y'all feel as far as Offset. Should he be able to have his own career? Should P have credits as far as from QCP? Should he have credits on his solo projects? Y'all let me know in the comment section.
It also
New Music Friday.
I can throw it out there. Sorry. If you ever watched Soul Food, when the Milestones or whatever, when they were performing that song, it was supposed to be Casey and JoJo, Babyface and his brother were supposed to make a group. Issue is, none of their labels could get it together for them to become a group and actually put out a full album. So it's just like, they wanted to do something. They were, technically speaking, a group and a movie, but like, they couldn't be a group in real life or really perform like the song that was a one of the songs that made the soundtrack to Soul Food, because the labels couldn't get it together to allow their artists to do different things. And your artist is, like I said, your artist is always going to grow and change, just like an actor is going to grow and change in the things that they do. You have to allow them, like, you have to give them room to grow. You have to be willing to say, absolutely, well, if you want to do something else, then what do you want to do? Like, sit down.
There's like, a lot of similar groups like that. Like I said, yeah. Hot Boys, it's a lot of groups like that. Oh, yeah, New Music Friday. Let's jump into it. DJ Khaled, of course, Offset, and Migos.
Nah, we just corner boys with the corner office. I'm at the cap table, what the splits is. Not that cap table, boy, we live this. Breezy, what the business is. We pushing 50 like fitting all. The shit is all legitimate. E was down 10 for this. We just got his 10 back, then went back like where the interest is. M light up the 03. We let y'all do the size, OG for the old.
Rich niggas coming down to the city.
On God.
Yo, bitch, outside getting litty. Showing me the titties. Ooh. Acting like a menace. Ooh. Standing on the couch. What? Standing on business. Look. Drinks in your mouth. Drink. Swallow, don't spit it. Swallow. Party all the time. Yeah. Yeah.
Christian Dior shop in Paris. Shopping in Paris.
I took a flight for the paddock, used to be.
My diamonds like porcelain. You can't call yourself rich if you do not own no mortgages. Sometimes when I'm home, I feel alone like it's an orphanage loan. When it's cold outside, you better grip on your heat. She got so much mileage, she tryna run.
I got the track list pulled up with all the people that's on here.
For God did.
Yeah. And he get a writer's credit and a producer's credit. But I just want to know, does he ever rap? Like, is that a thing?
No. No.
Does he just say, we the best music? Is that it? We the best music. And then, you know, everybody else do their thing.
It's like the same thing that DJ Drama do, but like, to me, okay, let me, I said like, similar. Anyway, I'm gonna just stick to this album. I'm not gonna compare, but this album, I feel like he gave each artist the best platform to shine on. I feel like each artist showed, like, they did what they do ability on the tracks that they were on. That's what I feel like. I feel like it was, I mean, how y'all feeling?
Are you going in there for me?
Uh-oh. I don't really be listening to DJ Khaled like that. I don't.
I don't either.
I'm not even like, I don't stan nobody, because I know where the word stan comes from, and I don't ever want to be a stan. I couldn't even say I was a fan. Like, you know, if they play it and I don't have no other choice, I might listen to it. Or if, you know, Spotify suggests it and I'm just like letting the music roll through and it plays and I like it, I'll listen to it. But yeah, hey, I guess if you give the artist the platform to, you know, talk they ish on whatever song it is, whether the person is singing or rapping, and the song is good and it'll help their career, I'm down for it. But it's just like, well, damn, let me make an album.
I give it
to you. DJ Khaled.
Let me make an album.
I mean, he not the first person to do this, though. What's home dude's name? Damn.
He's been doing this for a long time, though.
No, I'm saying, but like, he not the first person to facilitate and take share writing credit on stuff, because they've been doing this. What is his name? Damn it. It's right now. It'll come up later on.
What's his name? What about the whole thing? Because everybody.
Quincy Jones.
Oh, okay.
It's the same thing. But with but just take artists, put them on a nice track, and like literally, he used to make albums like this. That's why it's like DJ Khaled, not the first person to do shit like this. He just the one that keep doing stuff like this and getting mad because he not winning awards for it. But that's a whole nother conversation.
Oh,
you give him credit for being able to do what he's done from different generation of rappers. Like he done came from rappers that we kind of grew up with knowing to this mixture of rappers that kind of came in the mix after the generation that we knew now to the newer generation of rappers. So he been around for a majority of the old generation and the newer generation.
I'm going to just say this. Joey Fatone from NSYNC went to school with him. And he said that man did not act like that when they was in school. He was not giving all of this when they was in school. He didn't have that energy about him. So I'm more inclined to listen to Joey than I am DJ Khaled.
I mean, if he was in school, then of course we all changed. Growing up and all that, he's gonna be different.
How much has he really changed? I mean, like, yes, physically, emotionally, all that shit, but like, were you not who you were in high school?
It's dependent because I'm not in his situation. Mm-hmm. Coming up and then getting into a whole situation like that, I'm probably I might be different.
No. He created a whole different character. That's what I feel like she's saying. Because to me, like, if you knew me in high school and then you catch me on the mic now, it's like I'm more elevated and more polished, but like it's still me. I'm still who I used to be. You know what I mean? It's just elevated and better.
Yeah.
And healed and mature and
that's what I was kind of saying, too, because it seemed like maybe he was more soft-spoken or something. That's kind of what it sounded like. Like, DJ Khaled didn't have that bravado that he has now.
I mean, maybe he didn't have self-confidence, and this is the exterior he built for to present to the world. Because, honestly, you can't be who you are. You can, but, like, you still have to wear some type of mask when you're showing the world because you can't just, like, give everybody your all. Because then, like, people are legit critiquing your, like, who you are. And then you get mad and then you be arguing with people online because they're trying to tell you you're not who you are. But, like, that's...
I got a perfect example of that.
I don't talk to people online.
I got a perfect example of what you just said. Cardi B. Love her.
Yes.
I wish she didn't go back and forth with these people. But it's just like she's a person who came up on social media and she used that to her advantage and she got where she is. Like, y'all can say whatever y'all want to say about her, but it's just like what you can't deny is the fact that, other than this latest, when she does drop something, you're gonna go listen to it whether you like or you don't like her. And that's why she always thanks the haters when she wins something, because it's just like y'all not realizing this. And I learned this, like, with wrestling. They were like, whether you cheer someone or you boo someone, you are still giving them a reaction that they need or want that is going to make the people in the back pay attention to them. If you cheering them, that means you could be a babyface. If you booing them, that means you could be a heel. Now, if you just completely dead silent, that means, oh, no, I don't know what this, I don't know what you're doing, but it's not working, and you're not about to cost me no more money. So either change up the gimmick or, you know, basically, I like to say when it comes to reality shows, get a storyline or hit the unemployment line is this whole thing. So when Cardi, who is a person who has been giving 100% of herself to the world since she was on social media, and then you get this fame and people are starting to feel like they know you even though they don't know you, because it's just like, you don't know me. You know what I give out to you. You know the person that I show you. Now me, I'm the same person on and off. I just may not be as, you know, as loud and really out there and giving my opinion as soon as I meet you, because I like to fill out energy. So I like to sit back, you know, listen to you. Because I personally feel, because I people watch, everything I need to know about you, you're going to tell me in the first 15 minutes of me knowing you, because I'm sitting back and watching you interact with these people. I want to see how you interact with people, because if it's just you and me and, you know, you're not on the rah-rah, you're not loud, you're not, oh, I'm going to fight this person, I'm going to do this. But then when you get around a group of people, it's like you just all up. I'm like, who are you? Because that's not the person I met. So that's why I like to sit back and people watch. And, you know, most people have been people watching her for a minute, And then, you know, sometimes when people are people watching you, they feel like they know you, but it's just like, I know what they're going to give me. Now, I don't know the deep, dark secrets that they ain't going to tell nobody. I don't know where the bodies are buried. And I mean the figurative bodies, not literal, because we're not that close yet. But people feel like they know her. So then if the I know you, oh, well, I can press you. And that's what they've been doing. And because you're giving your all to people,
then that's they who she is. She's a real individual and she's a human. Yeah. She ain't even, I still feel like, has captivated that stardom yet still. She still is more us than anybody. She's just like, no, I'm not them. I'm still y'all still. And that's why she always responded.
Yeah, and a lot of people feel like, you know, she has to, you know, she needs to take breaks. She needs to do that. She does take breaks and she does, like, give social media a break. But then it's just like,
she don't need to handle her own social media.
And that's the issue with the thing. And
she don't want nobody speaking for her.
And she
doesn't.
I don't think she should be handling her own social media. But the issue is, this is what started her career. Yes, she was putting out mixtapes, and I still go back and listen to the mixtapes because, you know, cheap ass weed. Oh, that's slap. Okay, and yes, she was on Love and Hip Hop for 2 seasons, but social media is what got her to Love and Hip Hop. And then it's also social media is what was driving her to get hostings and putting her music out and, you know, getting people to listen to her mixtape. So in a sense, maybe some way she feels like she owes, like, her success to social media. And then it's just like, well, y'all met me this way. I'm the same person that I am now. I was back then. The same person I was back then, I am now. I've just become older. I've learned the business. I have 2 children. I have my bonus kids. I have a husband. And then that's also a hard thing because I don't have kids. But I get, like, when people start talking about people's kids, it's just like, well, all bets are off. I can't help it.
Are y'all kind of surprised that Cardi and Nicki not on the new DJ Khaled album?
Nicki, no. I have my thoughts about that situation too. But with the whole Nicki thing, I don't think she liked that man. And that was after that man said,
as far as Khaled.
After the man said he don't eat the buffet, and she said, well, you know, you's a bigum. How you not eating listen, I told you to go check out Nova Reads. That's what she calls a woman's nether regions when it comes to the whole situation.
Yo, I don't want to do this no more.
He said he don't be eating at the buffet. And she like, well, how you not eating at the buffets and you's a bigum? And it's just like, I don't know. I don't know if they like cool now. I don't know that situation. It could be a something of, you know, she can't go nowhere without her husband. And then, you know, her husband can't be around certain people. And then with the whole Cardi thing, it's just like Cardi doing her own stuff. You know, she drops music here and there, but she has, like, the deal with Reebok. She has her Facebook show.
You make more money for being an influencer.
The Cardi
ain't necessarily got to drop music like that.
The Cardi tries things.
Nicki ain't got to do shit but breathe. How many years she in the game? She can breathe.
Number one record, by the way, as far as Nicki Minaj.
Yeah, shout out to her.
I still don't like the song, but whatever.
Yeah, I didn't listen to it because we
talked about that. I said it sounded kind of dated. I was wrong as far as what people felt about it. That was my opinion. I still feel like it.
That's why I said all Nicki got to do is breathe. As an artist, I'm always challenge you to do better. So I'm going to speak my truth about how I feel about other people's artistry.
She was the only one that could get on that beat as far as Super Freaky Girl. That's only a Nicki Minaj that can get on that beat like that, as far as, in my opinion, female artist. And I don't like saying like that, female artist. I feel like rapper-wise, she was the only one that could rap on that beat.
Yeah. There are some people who, you know, you hear something and be like,
the beat ain't that only complicated, but okay.
Go ahead. I want to ask you, Medea. I'm going to get to because you was like...
There's some people that... Listen, I didn't listen to the song. Because I got my own thoughts on how, like, the lady in her situation, like, I'm good. Like, I've been off Nicki since she was gaslighting and bullying a black woman in favor of a white girl who was blackfishing, and I was like, you know what? I'm gonna have to take a step back. Now, I don't fool with her fans, because her fans give cult like, and I.
You're a coon. You're a nigger.
Not the Viola Davis.
Sir, you don't know about that whole situation, and then she tried to say,
you don't know about the situation.
New Music Friday. Did y'all just hear the Jay-Z verse?
No, I mean, I listened to the whole album. So, like, that's why I said, like, to me, he gave everybody a chance to shine on where they do best. That's why I was like, I like this. Can I say it's a good album? I don't know if I can really say that. But, like, to me, it's good songs on a collaborative album. I don't know. Like, to me, I can't say it was good. I could just say, like, I like the songs and I like most of the songs. But, like, is this an album I'm gonna go back? If I want to listen to a bunch of different artists do what they do best, yes, I will go back and listen to this. But I also make playlists, so this is just like a playlist to me. Like, yeah. I cannot fully be like, this album was just immaculate. But everybody did their thing and they did it well. That's all, like,
it's like the continuity of an album. Like, talking about Meg's album, her album is all about healing. You get that from the title, and then you get that from every single song that is on there. It's about healing for her. So there's a concept, there's a theme. The songs have continuity to them. Beyonce's album, the song's just like, you be listening to the song, and then it get to the next song, and it's just like, Miss Girl, why am I on the next song? I was just listening to this one. But it's like the album has a theme. It has continuity. It flows really well. This, in the sense of an album, I don't think it flows well in the sense of, you know, you have these people on here who are doing what they do best.
But you know, DJ Khaled is not an artist. He's a DJ. He's just going to be ad-libbing. He's a hype man. So it's different from Beyonce.
Well, no, not even
that's
that.
What he
I'm
does.
I'm not even talking about, like, the person as an artist. I'm talking about the way an album gets put together. When you are listening to an album,
the structure of the album.
Yeah. Does the album have structure? Does it flow really well? What is the theme that you can find throughout this album? From Beyonce's album, I was like, oh, we gonna party.
The theme is God did.
God did.
Every artist, every rap on this song say that. They mention it. God did.
But it's just
in some kind of way they talking their shit about how God did stuff for them.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, okay, good for you.
Which allowed them to do stuff for other people.
I was like, also, this is just like one big playlist. Quit playing with me. You was right. It's one big playlist. It's just like, if I want to listen to Lotto, I just go listen to Lotto. Because it's now on her discography on the Spotify. If I want to listen to Eminem, a.k.a. Marshall, I'll just go to hit down to the Spotify and, you know, listen to
Eminem. Hey, shout out to Eminem. He got a feature on here with Kanye. I didn't expect.
I like that song.
I'm not going to listen to Kanye.
But it's not a standout. If they would have made this 5 years ago, this would have been a standout song.
I'm not going to listen to Kanye. If I want to listen to
Sid. I like the Lotto and City Girl song.
Okay, right. If I'm going to go listen to the City Girls, I'm going to go listen to the City Girls. Like, you can find all these songs on their discography now, because even though it's DJ Khaled's album and he's doing the ad-libs and everything, talking about, we the best music and all that good stuff.
I got to give him credit.
Song.
That and Future and SZA collaboration was perfect. That went together like...
And it's just
I
like,
wonder why they ain't had enough songs together previously.
Child, we still waiting on SZA's album, but I'm not gonna say nothing because then she gonna get mad and block me. And
why did I bring up SZA?
Because it's certain people I'm trying to get blocked by, but SZA is not one of them, girl. I still listen to The Weeknd, okay? You like
that? I get that remix with Tim's.
I was like, no, I don't want to get blocked. It's just one big playlist. It's okay. We can admit it. It's just one big playlist.
Besides the extracurricular songs, the Jay-Z verse, though. Is this one of the best Jay-Z verses of all time? Because people out here kind of like, oh, this is it. This is that Jay-Z verse. Like, and I think more than anything, people are putting that sauce on there because he's rapping so long. He's just continuing. Yeah. Twitter and all that's what they say.
Like I said, like I was telling you earlier, it's not the most lyrical, but it's what he's talking about and how he's talking about it. That's what I like. Like yeah. I to me, it's just like he is so much in his bag and in his zone. Like this is like I like the way he's talking. Like that's all I can really say. Like but a I ain't gonna sit there
as billionaire.
Exactly, but I'm not gonna sit there and be like, this is the best shit. No, I was like, this is why you great at what you do, because you do it at this level, and it's like this is like,
you know what it is, too. I think it's motivation, too, because he sounds like he's talking to us. It like, is. Y'all better get y'all get up and do it, too.
That's what it is. It got niggas emotional. When you hit a nigga, see, this is what I was talking about, because he's speaking from his real life experience and talking. I love it. I love it when dudes is like, I love it when dudes be vulnerable on the track. I love it. And to me, like, that's like, I don't know. I felt motivated by the shit, but like, I'm not going to sit there and put all that extra fucking sauce on there. Like, I thought it was a cold ass verse. You see, I was not like going farther than that.
I liked it. It's a deeper thought. You gotta go back and listen to it.
You don't know.
I had to put my glasses on, and then I held that. Bro, I was Dominican challenge out here. Quit playing with me. Now, is it motivational? Yes. Is it speaking to the soul? Yes. Is it telling you to do the opposite of what his wife did on Break My Soul? Yes. Is it the best?
Yeah,
they trick. Because he's had others. Okay, he's had others. Quit playing with me. It's these. Hold on. Let me put it back on. It's y'all. These my fume glasses. Anyway, it's y'all younger. I never listened to none because my mom and my daddy wasn't bumping it, even though, you know, my mama shouldn't have been playing his music when I was younger. But, you know, that's my mama. She going to do what she want to do.
Especially when we talking about a bunch of people coming off of YB is better. So it's like,
y'all it's believe based off of.
And Youngboy is very talented, by the way. NBA Youngboy is very talented.
I don't know that man like that, so I wouldn't know. Anyway, my ears are selected. But y'all don't know about the music he was putting out back then. Listen, I still go and play Big Pimpin'. I don't know why. Maybe it's because, you know.
Oh, I know why.
Maybe it's because.
It was ingrained in us.
Yes.
And that beat, produced from Timbaland, that's still 2022. Yeah.
Yeah, you just automatically go to the beach.
Then you got UGK, Pimp C verse come up. No, yeah, that's.
And then the video, you got Gloria Velez and Pimp C, and her like birthday outfit, the little cowboy hat and the white leather with the fringe and everything. And then she got
everything about this shit is iconic. Yeah.
And then she got they came and got her, and it was like, you want to be in a video? She was like, yeah, you got something to wear? She was like, my birthday outfit. Put the birthday outfit on, and then Pimp C was like, here, you can wear the coat. He ain't never let nobody wear that coat.
Again, I don't know if these certain things are going down in 2022 videos, but...
They're not.
See, that's the difference between our era and this era, is the fact that we wasn't calling that shit a classic when it first fucking came out. We gave that shit time to mature and ripen, and then we go back and listen to it, because it's a lot of shit that I can admit that I go back and listen to, and I be like, this shit, it would not hit right now. But then there's some other stuff, I'm like, this a slap right now. Like, nah. It's a lot of stuff that I'm like, it's very dated, it's very of the time, and I can admit that. And some stuff is frankly not even good. Like, I can go back, I can tell you some shit on my playlist where I was like, this song is not good at all. But, like, it did something for me at that time period when I listened to it, which is why our parents and every other generation before us argues that their music is the best. No, it's the
same thing we're going to be doing.
I'm never gonna argue that my music. Well, like, nope. Let me not say never, because I did when mumble rap first came out. I was like, "What the fuck is this? Can it go away?" But
listen. We will like people be like, "Oh no, my generation had the best music." No, my generation had the best music. I'm like, I'm not arguing with y'all about who had the best music. Like, I'm DJ Khaled out here on a beat. Let's be clear on something. Every single generation, y'all talking about the same thing. It just sometimes it may just be like a little simple, a little shy. Sometimes it just be out there and proud with it. Sometimes you got people begging. Like, I'm like, come on now. Jodeci used to beg. Y'all don't beg no more. Maybe that's how the reason R&B died. They was begging. Baby,
I'm begging. You ain't going there. So you on P. Diddy's side? You saying R&B is dead?
They stopped reaching for the air. They stopped singing in the rain. What happened?
So you saying there's no more baby making music? It's playing baby music.
It's jokes. Not playing baby music. Yes, sir. Yes. They fucking mad. Ain't no sex. Ain't no love making. Ain't no.
What the fuck are you struggling for? Is something wrong with your back? Yeah.
Ain't no joining of the souls. Ain't no kundalini rising. I need some kundalini rising, damn.
But it's just like, what? No, like y'all arguing about whose music is the best from which generation. It's just like y'all say the same thing over and over and over again each generation, because the problems are still the same. People still begging for stuff, but now nobody's begging for anything. Nobody's
talking about anything. It's called evolution. People evolve. It is. Music evolves all the time.
People evolve, people's problems evolve, music evolves. Sometimes it evolves into something. It's just like, let this never happen again. And a song that I will always go back to, Mint Condition's Pretty Brown Eyes, I could play that all day. I could play it until somebody get tired of it. I'll play it till I get tired of it and then turn it off and play it again, because that's how good that song is. But I'm
Outcast, not... Outkast, Return of the Gangster. I played it, repeat.
But it's just like, I'm not sure. Or me, because I like all types of music. I just can't stick to one genre.
Well, I appreciate that as far as, though, the Jay-Z verse.
Yeah.
Because I feel like that's not the standout verse of all time that he has done. I feel like he has had more personal verses, too. The one with him and Benny Single, Dad, Where Are You? Like, that, like, come on, what are we talking about? No, you don't get more personal than that. Talking about your pops, even Blueprint, the song called Blueprint, where he talking about his dad and his mama and everybody that came along as far as his upbringing.
I think the reason why the people down to the Twitter think is the most